Well, good evening. It's good to be together again on this Wednesday night, and we're continuing our series Encounters with Jesus. Tonight, I'm going to be talking about Jesus encountering the fears that we have and how we encounter Him or can encounter Him in the midst of all of the difficulties that life brings us. In the sermon on Sunday, Pastor Steve talked about our reaction to the election. And we have had a lot of fear, a lot of discussion, a lot of difficulty with this election as a people, probably because we're in the midst of a pandemic. The election was a little contentious, and everybody had very strong views. And so, no matter what outcome had been, I think there would be half of the nation that was worried about what was going to happen, and the other half of the nation thinking the right thing happened. And so, tonight I want to address the fact that we as Christians need not be fearful. And that's easier said than done. And I am a perfect example because I can catch myself getting very fearful very easily, especially with the temper and the all of what's going on with life today. So let's open in prayer. Lord, thank you that you bring us together in your word. Thank you that you have promised to never leave us or forsake us. Let us hang on to those promises. Let us hang on to you. Let us see you in the midst of all the craziness that's going on. And let us see you, Lord God, as ruler of all, and that you have a plan, and that we are a part of that plan. So, Lord, bless what we say tonight. Bless your word to our hearts and minds, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, all of us face fears, big ones, small ones, fears of our own making. In fact, sometimes I think those fears are bigger than the actual reason for fear. Because we build things up in our minds when we're little children. I think all kids, most kids anyway, go through the fear of what's under the bed. And that builds up in our minds so that they're monsters. And I spent a lot of time with my daughters when they were growing up assuring them that there was nothing that was going to harm them in the middle of the night. Well, I think fear is a natural reaction. We have a chemical reaction when we are afraid. Fight or flight reaction is a good one. God gave that to us so that we could be protected. That adrenaline shoots through us, we get extra strength when something is happening that is dangerous for us. We feel fear and then we react. And so none of us leaves this world unscathed by fear, and not all fear is bad. We teach our children not to touch a hot stove because they would get burned. We want them to fear that burn. We teach them not to go out in the street when a car is coming because we want them to fear what would happen if that car hit them. They don't automatically know that. They have to be taught. Well, on the other side of that is fear that is taught to us that we shouldn't hang on to. Fear of the unknown. Fear of what's going to come 3 or 4 months down the road. And some of those fears are legitimate because we see what's happening in the world. That's the kind of fear that we can place in the hands of Jesus. We can trust Him with that kind of fear because we don't know what's going to happen. And all we can control is our reaction to those things that we fear, to those things that come up in life that we are sure could hurt us. So think about it for a minute. We have three questions, maybe more, about fear in our lives. Think about these as I go through them. What are some of our deepest fears? Think in your minds for a minute. What's a deep, deep fear? Some people fear the loss of a loved one. That's a very big fear. Or the loss of a job, economic opportunity. Some people fear the loss of health. Now, when we're young, at least most of us when we're young, we don't even think about our health. It's just a given. But as we get older and things happen to our bodies, that's a very real fear. What are some other fears that we have? Maybe the fear of engaging with people. There are some people that are have agoraphobia, and there are phobias, and so that fear over natural desire to be with people or to engage whatever it is that we are fearful of. So think for a minute, you may even want to jot down what is a deep fear you have, or maybe two or three deep fears that in the middle of the night when you wake up, they come. You think about them. The second, what would be the ultimate outcome if that fear happened? Now, this is almost a self-help kind of thing. Here's my fear, and to put it in perspective, if it happened, if I lost my job, what would the ultimate outcome be? If I lost a loved one, what would the ultimate outcome be? If someone broke into my house, because we fear that, what would the ultimate outcome be? So when we have a fear, sometimes it's good to take it just down the road and see where it leads. If it's irrational, or if it's something we need to be aware of and take precaution against. And then finally, how do we handle fear? Where do we put it in our lives? Do we deny it? Sometimes. I think athletes deny their fear all the time because they are pushing their bodies to the nth degree. And perhaps that fear is healthy fear, and then they overcome it to get to the next level of physicality. I marvel at the very few people who swim the English Channel. I don't know why that has struck me, except that I can swim maybe the length of the swimming pool, and I think I've done a great job. I would fear having to swim a long distance. I don't think I could do it. When we lived in Nigeria, we went to what was called up the creek. There you took kind of a rickety boat up the creek to a particular area, and it was actually for us poor people who were missionary types and teachers to have a recreational area. And so we'd get there, and we were kind of on a beach, and it was lovely, and then you had to take that rickety boat back. Well, when we got on the rickety boat to go back from being up the creek, there were not enough life preservers. And so we had to decide who got to have one or not. My oldest daughter volunteered not to have one because she was a good swimmer. I volunteered that she should have one because I feared that if she got thrown out of the boat or the boat sunk, which honestly it looked like it would at any moment, she wouldn't be as strong a swimmer as she thought because of panic. So how do we handle the fear we have with what we can do? And then what do we do with that fear when we have done everything we can possibly do? That's what tonight's lesson is about. So let's take a look at the scripture. This is just a short little scripture. It's in two or three of the Gospels, and it's about Jesus coming to the disciples at night on the lake. When evening came, Jesus' disciples went down to the lake, where they got into a boat and set off across the lake for Capernaum. By now it was dark, and Jesus had not yet joined them. A strong wind was blowing, and the waters were rough. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were frightened. That would be shocking if you looked up and Jesus was walking towards you. But he said to them, "It is I, don't be afraid." Oh my goodness. We need to memorize that. When we are in deep waters, rough waters, Jesus is saying to us, "It is I, don't be afraid." He will come to us. Then the disciples were willing to take him into the boat. And immediately the boat reached the shore where they were heading. Now imagine, these guys are fishermen. They've been on those waters many, many times. They knew what the Sea of Galilee was like. They knew that it got really rough at certain times of the day. They'd been through that. But that night, the waters probably were a little rougher, and the boats were not that particularly big and strong. And then here comes this apparition on the water. Can you imagine? Did they think it was a ghost? Did they think, what would they have done? Nobody walks on water. Jesus anyway. And then when they realized who it was, when they heard his voice, they decided, I love this, that they were willing to take him into the boat. I picture him standing up there going, how long do I have to stand here, guys? On the water, with the rough seas. And immediately then, and this is the important part, we'll talk about in a minute, notice the word immediately. When you see one of those words, immediately, nevertheless, therefore, there's another one I just love and I can't think of it. But immediately, that means there was no time in between. Jesus steps in the boat and they have made it to shore. That is a fast trip. There are some other verses in Scripture that support this. In the Old Testament, that give us kind of a look, a prophetic look at what Jesus was doing at this moment. Psalm 77:19, your path led through the sea, your way through the mighty waters, though your footprints were not seen. You can picture that. We didn't see Jesus' footprints on the water. You can't see footprints on the water. But your path led you through the sea. Another one, they saw the works of the Lord, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke and stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves. And finally, then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper, the waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. This is almost exactly what happened when Jesus walked on the water and met the disciples. This is very prophetic in how Jesus met them on the sea. And here's the one in Isaiah. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. Now, I encourage you to mark these in Scripture. And when you are going through something, when you have fear, when something may be happening that you cannot control, read these Scriptures. Psalm 77:19, Psalm 107, 24 and 25, and 28 to 30 was what I had before. And then this Isaiah passage, Isaiah 43:1-3. These are powerful verses. And then, when I was teaching this morning about prayer, I talked about how Scripture informs our prayer. Well, how much does this inform us in our praying? Lord, take me through this fear I have. Take me through whatever it is I'm going through. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. We belong to God, so we can call on him. And when you go through those tough times, I'm going to be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they won't sweep over you. One time, my daughter was going through a very, very, very difficult time. It's very frightening to her. Of course, being a mom, I wanted to fix it, and there was absolutely nothing I could do about it. She was an adult. I couldn't control what was happening to her, and so we decided to pray. And we decided to pray a scripture in 2 Timothy 1:7. I have not given you... Oh my gosh, I've just lost it now. I did not give you a sense of fear, but I said, I'm going to read it. I'm going to get in and read it because I'm not going to do this right. I did not give you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and love and self-control. That's what it is. And so every night we prayed that together. 2 Timothy 1:7. I did not give you a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and self-control. Now, some translations don't say fear. They say another word that means the same thing. And so we prayed that. And in the end of that whole situation, and it took several months to get through it, but in the end of that whole situation, not only did she see God working in her life, but she saw how God used that incident, which was very difficult, to bring good for her life. Now, we didn't know that was going to happen. We didn't even assume that was going to happen. We just wanted to pray for her protection, and God brought more. And so, pray scripture. Pray these verses when you're going through a tough time. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Matthew Henry has said, if we have received Christ as Lord, have received him willingly, nobody twisted our arm, but we came to Jesus, we knew he wanted a commitment from us. We've been through all of the I don't knows, and now we've said, yes, Lord. If we've done that, though the night be as though may be dark and the wind high, yet we may comfort ourselves with this, that we shall be at shore shortly and are nearer to it than we think we are. So when we're going through a tough time, and all of us have been going through a tough time, and we keep hoping that these little things will happen to make this time not so tough. Oh, maybe we'll get a new vaccine quicker, and the vaccine will work, and everybody will get it magically fast. Probably not. Though the night be dark and the wind high, yet we may comfort ourselves with this. Not that we are going to get a vaccine, though that is an act of God, but that we shall be at shore shortly and nearer to it than we think we are, and are nearer to it than we think we are. God is in our lives, walking with us through the hard times and the good. Because sometimes we get so caught up in the wonderful things that are happening, we forget him also. Well, in this particular passage, let's see if I can get that back. Okay, I'm going to go back to the other passage here. In this particular passage in John, the night is approaching. It's dark on the water. And where is Jesus? We don't know. We don't get to know. The disciples don't know where he is. They had been expecting him evidently, but he hadn't shown up, so they got in the boat to go to the other side. Maybe they thought he'd already gone ahead of them, or he was going to come later. But we don't know where he is. He had slipped away from the crowd, and Jesus often did this for two reasons. One, because they couldn't leave him alone, and he would never get a rest. And to pray. Jesus often slipped away from the crowd to go and pray, to just reignite himself, to reassure himself, to be in the presence of God, to talk with the Father, to get powered up again, to get that sense that he was not alone. And that must have been an amazing sense that he had. So we don't know where he is. He slipped away from the crowd. Perhaps he told the disciples he would catch up with them and go on to them so they should go on to Capernaum. We don't know that. But they certainly were not expecting him to walk on water. Nobody would have expected that. Think about walking on water. How many times have you made that comment about somebody? Well, they don't walk on water. Or they think they walk on water. That's a direct reference to Jesus walking on the water because, of course, he was perfect and he could do it. None of us is probably going to be able to do that unless we have a hoverboard. So walking on water is usually a comment about someone who either looks like they're perfect or thinks they're perfect. They can do no wrong. This is a false expectation or belief, and that for someone who really doesn't think that about themselves, when we put them in that position, that's difficult, that's hard. And sometimes we use it as a derisive comment. Well, they think they can walk on water, but I can tell you they don't. So it's in our vernacular, it's in our conversation. Well, Jesus is out there. Jesus isn't there yet. The boat is out there with the disciples. The waters become rough and windy. I have just finished reading a book called The Exiles. And I don't even know where I got this book. I think I might have seen it advertised on Amazon or something. It looked interesting. It was about some of the first settlers going to Australia. And, of course, they were prisoners. England got rid of their prisoners first by sending them to the United States. Well, when the United States, well, to the colonies. And when the colonies no longer would accept them, then they had this vast piece of land, deserty land, in the middle of nowhere, a big island continent. They got perfect. It took 4 months to get there. And so these prisoners were put on this boat, and they were treated as prisoners on the boat. They were put down in the lowest level, but they weren't rowing the boat. They were just passengers being taken to prison in Australia. And once they served their sentence, then they were free, but they would have to stay in Australia and still. And so most people in Australia, not most now, but for many, many, many years until recently, almost everyone in Australia has a convict in their background because that's who settled in Australia. Well, this book, The Exiles, is about women who were taken there and serving out their prison sentences in not very good conditions, but not horrendous conditions in Australia. When they are on the sea, they get so seasick, because the ship that they were on really was not a very good ship, it didn't have the weighting, and it wasn't a cruise ship. Let's put it like that. And so it was dangerous. They were very sick while they were on that, at least for the first few weeks, and then they were on there for 4 months, and so they must have gotten used to it. And I thought of them, how much they would probably have appreciated Jesus walking on water and getting their boat to its destination, not in 4 months, but just in 4 hours. The exiles end up, as they get to Australia, making a land, making a new life. And that's what Jesus is all about. When he comes into the boat with us, he's about changing our lives, redeeming us, as the scripture said. Well, the scene is set for a miracle as Jesus is walking on the water. It's a dark and stormy night. You can see the movie. It's mid-sea. There's no port in sight, and an absent Jesus. And the disciples think they're on their own. Now, when we see horror movies, or there are a couple of funny TV commercials about horror stories, it usually starts with a dark and stormy night. They may not say those words, but there's lightning in the background and clouds, and it just looks ominous. Well, this is no horror story for the disciples. It's their life. And yet, you can hear the music in the background. If this is in the movie, it's tenuous and it's ominous. It seems as if John is trying to help the early church understand that the difficult and sometimes terrible persecution they are going through was similar to these stormy waters. And Jesus is still here, and he's going to come and enter the boat with you. There were no storms in Gethsemane on the night Jesus was alone praying. He actually wasn't alone. He was with his disciples, but they had fallen asleep. But he asked them for support. The tables are turned on that night in Gethsemane. And Jesus prays and opens his heart to God. He says, "Take this away, or your will be done." Let me get to the Luke. "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." It's hard for us, it's hard for me, to picture Jesus being afraid. And I don't know if he had ultimate fear about what was to happen, because he knew why he was here. But immediate fear, who would want to go through, as his fully human side, what he had to go through? And so he must have felt that sense of anticipation, anxiety about what he knew was ahead of him, because he was fully human, just like you and I, even though he was fully divine. And so the scripture tells us, does it say that? No, I don't think this. Yeah, oh, that's the other one. Okay. So the scripture cancer goes on to tell us in Luke that he was in such anguish that drops of blood fell from his forehead. Now, there's an actual medical reason for that. That has a medical term. But Jesus knew he was sweating blood. And we have that as a term in our own vernacular. Jesus knows what he's going to face. He knows the outcome. He has to go through the horror. That's what we may have feared. That's what he may have feared, if indeed it was fear. John 6:19. So we get back now to our scripture. It says, when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus approaching the boat, walking on the water, and they were frightened. Now, I don't know if you've ever rowed a boat, but 3 or 4 miles, even though these were fishermen and they were used to it, that's a lot in a stormy sea. When my husband and I, Frank and I, were young, we had been invited to the Lake of the Ozarks by friends, and we got into a rowboat with a couple of others and rowed out to a bigger boat where we were having this party. I remember absolutely nothing about the party or the people. I don't even know who we were there with. I don't remember any of that. But I do remember what happened. We got back done with the party. We got back on a boat. Somebody rowed us back across. We went up to the car. Frank feels for his wallet, and it's not there. So we had to go back to the, we had to go down and go back to the big boat to get his wallet, because he kind of remembered he might have taken it out, because he might have, you know, all of those kinds of things. Well, we got into this boat. Now, Frank was, he's a big guy, and in those days, he was an athlete, a very strong athlete, but he had never, ever, ever rowed a boat. So we get in this rowboat, and we're going in basic circles. He has no clue what he's doing. So I, who was a Girl Scout and had been taught to row a boat, and I was teensy-tiny in those days, I said, give me the oars. I was just so frustrated, and it was getting dark. So he said, you won't be able to row us. And I said, just let me try. I got those oars. We went and got the ball and back to shore. He didn't say a word. But it's hard. It's hard work to row, even when the water is calm. These guys were rowing in a storm 3 or 4 miles. That's a lot of work. And now, it seems terrifying, but he said to them, it is I, don't be afraid. They are terrified with this apparition. How would we see it? Would we see it as a trick, a hologram? You know, they didn't have holograms back in Jesus' time. Do, and it looks as if, we can make it look as if somebody's doing something that they aren't really doing. But it had to have some explanation. There is no technology in this situation. There wasn't any technology back then. Seeing was believing. And this seeing is recorded because the disciples saw it, and they tell people as they're writing the Gospels, or as the Gospel writers are writing the Gospels, what they saw. They didn't have a modern explanation. All the other miracles they had seen, and think about this, every other miracle they had seen Jesus do was very impressive, and it helped other people. He healed the sick. He sent the demons away. He turned water into wine. He was helping other people with their needs. This one was very different. So what's the point? This miracle. The commentators believe that it was to teach the disciples and the whole church that Jesus is Lord of all, even the seas, including all of nature. So when hurricanes come, and we've had plenty of them, you know, when hurricanes come here in Arizona, we don't think about it. But if you've ever been in, I haven't been in a hurricane, I've been in many tornadoes in the Midwest. They are very frightening. And here we just have, it's hot. And so we can control that. We can go into the air conditioning. You can't control a hurricane or a tornado. So here we have the point of this miracle, to teach the disciples that Jesus is Lord of everything. Absolutely. church is going through its storms, and when early Christians are going through persecution, that Jesus will come. A larger, more philosophical reason that this miracle is in Scripture is very interesting about where this miracle is placed. If we went back and read John, this miracle comes after the feeding of the 5,000. And so, it's this nice juxtaposition of Jesus taking care of people's physical needs, and then Jesus taking care of nature. Jesus shows the church that they need to be about both things, about social justice, taking care of people's needs, and about evangelism, the fully human and fully divine Jesus. When I was at my former church, I was put in charge of mission, probably 3 or 4 years into my ministry there. And we had a very strong ministry to the African-American community in Tacoma, Washington. It wasn't with them. We did a lot of work with the African-American church, one of the African-American churches there. Well, I don't know how this happened. I have no idea how this happened, because I've lost the detail, except that I do remember I went with an organization we were working with to Mississippi, and then on to Texas. While in one of those places, a man named John Perkins was speaking. John Perkins, many people know who he was, many don't, but he was one of the early civil rights leaders that was with Martin Luther King, and he truly, truly believed that there would never be reconciliation between the races except in Christ. And he worked for that very hard, in very practical ways. Well, I was in this meeting, and I was sitting there, and someone introduced me to him. And I had been doing quite a bit of work in that area. And John Perkins goes, before the guy said my name, John Perkins says, "Oh, yes, you're Reverend Linda Corson." I said, "How do you know that?" And he said, "I've heard what you've been doing." I said, "Why would you hear what I'm doing in one church in one small town in the United States?" And he said, "Because we're working together to bring about social justice and faith to everyone. And so I keep my finger on the places that are that's happening." I've never forgotten that. Not because I was so great or I deserved to know him, he was one of the most humble people I've ever met, but because he got it. Jesus, fully human and fully divine, people need social justice, but they also need Jesus. It's not one or the other. Jesus is as earthy as hungry people, and as heavenly as the endangered disciples, or those who would literally face danger and death because of their faith. Some of the most joyful Christians I've ever met have very little, and they share far more than their 10%. When you have $100 and you share 10% of that $100, you're giving far more than if you have $1 million and you give 10% of that $1 million. And I've seen both sets of people, and they're both wonderful. But when I taught at Lincoln High School, there were people who could not do enough for me because they were so grateful for what was happening with their kids, and that I was a woman of faith, and they were women and men of faith. And so they shared a little bit that they had with all of us. When we minister to the physical needs of people, we are representing Jesus, feeding them, whatever that physical need is. Because people really can't focus on much else if they're super hungry or cold or have no place to live. They can only focus on the physical until that need is maybe not completely obliterated, but helped. I had a friend on the other end of the spectrum, aside from the people of Lincoln High School. His name was George, and he was incredibly wealthy. He had made some very good investments. He bought large pieces of land in Hawaii and Alaska before they became states. And so he had a lot of extra money. Well, George figured that God had showed him how to do that. And so that money really wasn't his anyway. So George took that money and he put it to use to meet the needs that people had. He literally, by himself, money-wise, built a wing of one of the hospitals in Tacoma, Washington, a huge wing. He redeveloped, I guess you would say, the chapel and the organ at Pacific Lutheran University, which was in Tacoma, Washington. He gave that money freely and never wanted any recognition because he knew that that's why God had given it to him. Well, sometimes God puts us in situations where we find that we can help people we didn't expect to help with gifts we didn't know we had. And God does that all the time. I think about this man at Lincoln High School. His name was Steve. Steve was a nominal, and still is, a nominal Jewish person. Every year, he was asked, because he was the only Jewish person on staff, he was asked by some of the world history teachers to come and talk about Israel and the development of Judaism. And every single year, he would call me the night before and ask me about the background of Judaism. He knew nothing. He didn't know about Moses and what Moses had done. He knew nothing about his own faith. But that man was one of the people I think Jesus loves so much. And I just know at some point he's going to meet Jesus because he passionately loved those kids at Lincoln. So much so that he would do anything it took to get them to college so that they could have a better life. And he's still doing that now that he's retired. And I could give you detail after detail of what he did, but he did it just because he really, really wanted to see them succeed, not because he cared if anybody knew he did it. All right, I need to get moving here. Jesus said to them, "I am, don't be afraid, don't be terrified." Then when they wanted to take him to the boat was at the very piece of land toward which they were headed. So Bill Bruner translates it like this. I'm going to read it. I didn't put it on the screen. "I am is the name God used with Moses at the burning bush. I am who I am." This is what you are to say to the Israelites. "I am sent me to you." And Jesus says, this translation says, "It is I," but it is the same word. "I am." And so Yahweh is there. That's what "I am" means. Yahweh. It's a form of the verb be. Yahweh, the great "I am," not uttered ever by a Jew because it's so sacred. In our age of terror, we need to remember the same. The Father gave Jesus authority over all things, and Jesus is exercising that gift in this little story. Now we go to the Matthew 11:27. "All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." So this amazing little verse tells who Jesus is. So of course he can walk on water. Of course, all things are given to him because he is God. And this is who we're dealing with. And this is one of my favorite passages of scripture ever. And I'm going to read it, and maybe you won't even close your eyes while I read it because it is so powerful. "The Son, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together." the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. When we are afraid, maybe we need to read these words to know who Jesus really is, to know that he is the one who is in charge of all things. He's in charge of the election. He's in charge of the outcome of COVID. He is in charge of how we respond to one another during these times. He's in charge when we get irritated at things that never would have bothered us before, but we're so isolated and we're so sick of this that we get irritated. He's in charge. We don't have to be. Now, that doesn't mean that we just sit back and say, well, General Jesus, meek and mild, will take care of me. I don't have anything to do. What it means is that we are not on our own and we don't have to control everything ourselves. Once you are alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's visible body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. When we are afraid, picture ourselves as God sees us, as Jesus saw those disciples as they saw him, free and without blemish before the Father. I'm going to go on to this next one. One of the things that I have learned to do when I'm having a hard time believing that Jesus is actually going to get in the boat with me, actually going to come across those terrible waters, is I pray this prayer. This is a prayer that was prayed by a man who had just given up. He tried everything to help his son. Nothing had helped. And so he goes to Jesus, and Jesus asks him, do you believe that I can help you? And he says, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. All of us are in that boat. I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. All of us are there. The disciples were there. They were afraid when they saw Jesus. They probably were afraid in the storm. Help my unbelief. When we pray the simple prayer, I want to believe, help me, Jesus hears us. When we are in over our head like the disciples were, Jesus hears us. He shows up. When we want to take one step deeper with him, remember Peter like that. I like the idea of getting out of the boat and walking toward Jesus in one of the gospel stories. And then he realizes what's going on and he starts to sink. When we want to take one step deeper with Jesus, he is ready to walk toward us and with us, even if we're afraid. Two miracles have happened here. Jesus has walked on the water, and the disciples arrive at their destination without rowing through the storm anymore. The moment they take Jesus into the boat. When we encounter our greatest fears, there are three things that we should do. One, look for Jesus in the storm. Two, take him into the boat with you. And I would encourage you to just picture that. And three, let him take you to safe harbor. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, that you are here. You're with us. In spite of all the stuff that's going on, we can trust you. And when we feel out of control, when things seem so very difficult, we pray that you will wrap us up in your arms and help us to rest in you, even if we're shaking. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much, and we will see you next week.